the National Wrestling Alliance, a huge conglomerate that dominated the wrestling landscape by housing some of the very best wrestling promotions from all over. However, it all came toppling down thanks to one Vincent Kennedy McMahon when he took his promotion, the World Wrestling Federation, and brought it national. But what if Vince didn't do that? Well, that very question is the topic of this episode, because today... Please support this channel by subscribing, and you could support it even further by signing up over on my Patreon page, just like with the Immortal Remus and Dakari Garmin. Thank both of you so much, and the rest of my Patreons as well, as all of you really help, and I can't thank you enough. Okay, so let's start this what off by stating the obvious, and it's that no one, not even myself, knows for sure what would have happened if Vince McMahon didn't take down the territories, and anyone asserting that they do is lying. This is just merely a fun thought experiment where I'll be running down several scenarios and talking about which ones I think are most likely based off of the evidence. And the evidence that I'll be talking about is mostly things that happened before 1982 when Vince took over the WWF. But that's not to say the things that happened afterwards are going to be taken under no consideration at all, they're just not going to have as much weight. Oh, and I guess we should also take into consideration the possibility that maybe the National Wrestling Alliance would still exist today as the territories, but I really don't think that's likely, and I'll get into why later on in the video. Okay, so now that we've talked about one Vincent Kennedy McMahon and him taking over the WWF, well, in this scenario, in order to be accurate, where exactly is he since he's not going to be taking down the territories? Well, for today, our hypothetical is simply that he just never got involved in the wrestling industry. Instead, he became a tax accountant or a physical trainer or, you know what, an hibachi chef. That's right, Vince McMahon works for Benihana in this alternate universe. And with that being said, what exactly would become of the World Wrestling Federation? Well, that brings us to our first scenario. Alright, so without Vince Jr. taking over, I think it's fair to say that Vince Sr. would probably have retained ownership of the company. And with that, is there a possibility that the OG Vinnie Mac Prime might have brought down the NWA if his kid never got the chance to do it? Paul Heyman famously cut a promo where he said that Vince McMahon Sr. promised that he and his son would never compete against the NWA, only for Vincent Kennedy McMahon to wind up breaking that promise. Now, whether this actually happened or not, who knows? But what we can say for certain is that Vinnie Mac Prime did appear in the movie The Wrestler, and not the one with Mickey Rourke. And in this small cameo, he and other real-life NWA wrestling promoters discussed the idea of putting on a mega event, a Super Bowl of... Now, the strange thing is, this is the name of an actual NWA show, two of them in fact, one which took place in 1972 before the movie and another one that took place in 1978 after the movie. But this all goes to show you that this is about as kayfabe as it gets, since we're talking about a scripted sport taking place in a fictional movie. And again, the real show was under the NWA banner. Furthermore, another reason why I don't think that Vince McMahon Classic would have gone against the territories is because, as I previously mentioned on this channel, Vince McMahon Sr. would rejoin the National Wrestling Alliance in 1971. It was Vince McMahon Jr. that would break away from the NWA for good. And so while the movie made it seem like Vince McMahon Classic might have been joining up with some other outside promoters, in real life this really doesn't seem to be the case, especially when we remember that one of those promoters was a fictional character portrayed by Ed Asner. Thus, I just don't see any reason to think that Vince McMahon Sr. would have taken down the territories. But that's not to say that there wasn't someone else in that movie who just might have done it instead. Once upon a time, the biggest wrestling promotion in America was the AWA, and this was the company that really fired the first shot in bringing down the National Wrestling Alliance. As a multitude of other promoters had grown frustrated with their position in the alliance, feeling that the NWA wasn't giving them everything that they promised. Now, who was the guy to spearhead all of this, and could he possibly have been the one to do what Vince McMahon did if Vince McMahon didn't do what he did? Well, I think that is rather likely. Continuing with talking about the movie The Wrestler, again not the Mickey Rourke one, Vern Gagne was one of the top stars in that film. And unlike the OG Vince, Vern Gagne never went back to the NWA, but he did break away from it in 1960. It all started when Gagne, who was a real-life Olympic competitor, decided that he really wanted the NWA championship, but to no avail. Now, I've already covered this in a previous video, so go ahead and watch that one for more information. But as a result, Gagne would take over the AWA, which would go on to become one of the biggest wrestling promotions that ever was, as at some points it even topped that of the NWA itself. So we already know that Gagne had the will to break away from the territories in the first place, and if Vincent Kennedy McMahon wasn't around, well, the AWA is probably the only promotion that even stood a chance of taking down the territories. And let's also remember that Gagne did also go national, well, kind of, when he joined Pro Wrestling USA, a conglomerate of several other wrestling promoters all looking to compete against the WWF and Vince McMahon. Now, of course, the AWA weren't the only ones involved in Pro Wrestling USA, but what about these other promotions? Did they have a chance of taking down the National Wrestling Alliance? Well, to answer that question, I would say no. I really don't think any of the other promotions involved in Pro Wrestling USA would have gone national. The CWA didn't seem like they wanted to, and as for Jim Crockett Promotions, well, we have to remember that Jim Crockett Jr. was the president of the NWA, so I highly doubt he would go against himself. But speaking of the CWA, let's remember that they would eventually merge with WCCW. And now that we think about it, how would World Class Championship Wrestling have fared? While it is true that World Class Championship Wrestling did separate from the National Wrestling Alliance, it didn't happen under the same circumstances like it did for many other promotions, since due to a combination of factors, most importantly, Jim Crockett Jr. deciding that the NWA World Champion Ric Flair would no longer wrestle in Texas, WCCW had no choice but to withdraw from the NWA, becoming the World Class Wrestling Association. But this appears to be more reflexive as to what the NWA did, and not so much a desire to expand nationally, even though they did have a major tour in the Middle East in the mid-1980s. And now, with that, I think it's important to note that just one show and one tour being done internationally doesn't make you an international promotion. Just like how promoting one match in a different state doesn't make you a national company either. Because when we talk about going national, we really mean you have to extend your borders beyond that of the territories, and on a routine and regular basis, you have to perform all over the country. One show, one time in a different state is just not gonna cut it. And not only that, but you also have to thrive in these other markets. It doesn't do you any good if you make no money when you go elsewhere. Going national means breaking down the boundaries of the territories, and making sure that you're so successful that you pretty much starve out any other promotion in the areas that you're invading. Because that's exactly what Vince McMahon did. Although, he's not the only one to understand aggressive expansion, as he ripped off a lot of his ideas from, well, the next entry on this list. When Bill Watts took over Tri-State Wrestling and turned it into Mid-South Wrestling, one of his first orders of business was to withdraw from the NWA. However, he would still maintain a very good working relationship with the Alliance, as the NWA would still have their world title competing on Mid-South Wrestling shows. Not only that, but in the early 1980s, Mid-South was also expanding. And also, let's remember that Bill Watts did take things national when he turned Mid-South into the Universal Wrestling Federation in 1986. However, that was after Vince McMahon had already done so. And sure, just like with Pro Wrestling USA, McMahon more than likely was the catalyst to hasten the process. But considering that Watts had already withdrawn from the NWA and was showing signs of expansion, I do think that it's fairly plausible that Watts would have went national anyway. It just might have taken a little longer. Now, it does appear that both Bill Watts and Vern Gagne are the most likely ones to achieve this task if it was to happen. But we're not done yet, because there is another promotion out there that stood a real good chance of going national, because in a way, they kinda did. Going back to 1976, Georgia Championship Wrestling was distributed via satellite, therefore making it the first NWA affiliate to broadcast nationally. And this move caused some to suspect that there was a possibility of Georgia Championship Wrestling becoming a national promotion. However, then company owner Jim Barnett said that there was no danger of that whatsoever, as that he was only using local talent. However, there are those who have disputed this, claiming that Barnett's goal was to take the company national, but he decided to not go through it, and after some organized crime members paid him a visit. Now, regardless as to what actually happened, we do know for sure that Barnett did not take Georgia Championship Wrestling national. And since the satellite broadcast happened back in 1976 before Vince McMahon took over the WWF, we know that the lack of expansion has nothing to do with Vince. But at this time, I think it's crucial that we make one big clarification. Just like with WCCW, and the difference between having one really successful international tour and being an international international company, so too are the rules the same for broadcasting. Just because you can be seen nationally doesn't make you a national promotion. And especially when we remember that satellite wasn't exactly the most successful television distribution medium, it's really easy to see why Georgia Championship Wrestling didn't count as a national promotion. But even though satellite wasn't the most successful, there was something that would come along that would be a huge game changer, and it all ties to Georgia Championship Wrestling, and it's what I think is really the biggest key to this equation. GCW would air on a channel that is now known as TBS, and it would air on cable television. And this right here is the big one, and it was also the major key to Vince McMahon's success in the first place. I know it's hard to imagine, but once upon a time, local television stations had a broadcast range that was only, well, local. If you wanted your programming to extend its reach further, then you would have to find a network of other stations to distribute your content. And if you wanted to be seen nationwide, then you would have to be a part of the national networks, CBS, ABC, and NBC. PBS doesn't count. However, this all went right out the window thanks to a thing called cable television, the exact invention that Vince McMahon exploited in order to get WWF seen all across the country. And no, as we already established, airing nationally isn't the same thing as being a national promotion. However, it's a really good way to start the process. Because if people all across America see your product and they like it, well, then they're more likely to want to see it when you do come rolling into town. And so, with the advent of cable television, and definitely with the advent of the internet, sooner or later somebody would have been distributed so large that becoming a national promotion was inevitable. And as such, there's no way that the territory system could have survived. And if the NWA didn't have the wherewithal to get with the times when they had the real-life threat of Vince McMahon, well, without them, I really don't see them evolving all that quickly. And so, I just think that it would be a matter of time before either Bill Watts, Vern Gagne, or maybe even Jim Barnett would have taken advantage of cable television and brought one of their promotions national. But what do you think would have happened if Vince McMahon didn't go national? Would the territory system still exist? And if not, who would have taken it down? Let me know down in the comments, and please make sure that you're subscribed to the Thinking Fans channel and that you're a member of the Know-It-All Nation. Thank you so much for watching, and thank you to all the amazing Patreon supporters out there. If you want to support this channel even further, please sign up on my Patreon page. And as always, Dave knows.